Okay, good evening. Welcome to second first talk this semester. We have Kameshwari who's going to talk to us about a somewhat different topic. It's not the usual pair you find at first, but she's going to talk about developmental projects that she's doing right now.
Okay, thanks all for coming. So I'll start the talk with a definition and a disclaimer, and then I'll continue. So before I begin, let me begin by defining what I mean by developmental projects. So any project that you have worked on will have some research, will have some development, but these are projects that are heavier on the developmental side, by which I mean you use the existing state of the art and try to use it to solve some very specific local problem. So when you start out with these developmental projects, to begin with, you think you know exactly what you should do. But halfway through, you realize you don't know. Things have become complex. And then you, thankfully, what exists, some research behind how to solve the problem, thankfully, already exists. So it's a method of adopting it and adapting it to the specific problem and then moving on. So that is how the development projects typically go on. Now, coming to the disclaimer portion of it, typically a life cycle of a project involves you get an idea, you execute the idea, you try it out, and then based on the feedback, you refine it, and then you push for wider adoption. So the disclaimer is that while I have experience with the first four, five is something that I'm trying to do. So whatever are the lessons learned, you should keep an eye. I didn't really finish the life cycle. I'm trying to complete it, but there are hurdles. And not just that, I have been focusing on this only in the last 3 years, more seriously. So whatever I'm presenting is based on my limited experience. So it's not like I have a lot of gyan to hand out, but whatever lessons I've learned, I'll share it with you. So as I mentioned, these are projects that take a pain point and try to solve it. So to ground the discussion, I'm going to start looking at one specific problem that we tried to solve, and we'll see the life cycle of solving this particular problem. So the problem we looked at was that the engineering education in India is rather poor, whether we can use technology to somehow help solve this problem. So let's start with what the background is. So we have around 3,345 engineering colleges that are producing 1.5 million engineering students. But unfortunately, majority of these are unemployed or underemployed. And we always hear that the industry often has to retrain the workforce. They recruit, then they train them before they can contribute. Not just this, we also in the academia complain a lot about that we don't get good enough PhD students where they don't have proper training. Again, you have to train them here. So all this involves a lot of expenditure, both in terms of money as well as time. So this is a big problem. So when we started trying to solve this problem, rather wanted to solve this problem, I had some very vague ideas. I'll tell you what these ideas are and how they got concretized later. So the vague idea, like, I was looking at this Khan Academy, which was a major source of inspiration. Khan Academy was doing things for school education. I thought whether something similar can be done for engineering education. So that is where the motivation was. So the idea was to create some video material. Now, why video material? Because the video material is more accessible to a student, because there is the way we teach, if you read a textbook, I mean, things may not be very clear, but the same thing if you explain via a video by emphasizing your voice or drawing a figure or pointing to something, it makes it easier for a student to understand. So that's why the video material. So all this resulted in what I call multimedia book. I'll tell what I mean by this book. So the idea was, let's create this good multimedia books, and then we will ask the teachers in the engineering colleges that are out there to use these multimedia books. Typically, I don't know how much you have interfaced with the teachers outside, their loads are very high. They often teach, we teach one course a semester, but they often teach 3-4 courses a semester. So the idea is, if you are providing such multimedia books, hopefully it will reduce the teaching load. That way they can spend more time interacting with the students in a flipped class setting. How many of you don't know what a flipped class is? People know? All of you know? Everyone knows? Okay. Okay. So let me explain what a flipped class is. This is again taken from Wikipedia, actually from someplace there. So traditional classes, what happens is a teacher comes to the class, imparts some instruction, and then the students go home, and then they try to solve some homework problems, whatever. That is the typical model. But in flipped class, the instruction is taken outside the classroom. So you are imparting the information, whatever it is that you want to convey, the knowledge, via videos that are to be watched before students come to the class. And during the class, you actually solve the problem. So the idea is, when you try to apply what you have learned, that is when you realize you really didn't understand much. And the instructor is handy to help you solve that particular, clarify whatever questions you have. So that is the flipped class mode of operation. So idea is, teachers will use these multimedia books and then conduct such flipped classes. So the end result of whatever of these thoughts was this platform called Bodhi Tree. I'll get into a bit more details about what this Bodhi Tree is. But the talk is driven that this platform provides three interfaces. One of content developers. Content developers are those who are creating the textbook, or the, rather I should say multimedia book. Instructors are those who are using the multimedia books to teach students. So these are the three interfaces that are going to arise. So this multimedia book is, some aspects of it is there, but again, let's look at the origin of how knowledge has gotten disseminated. So the printing press was a major revolution. So we have been using the textbooks that have resulted out of it until the 2000s. Of late, people use PDFs, or they refer to the HTML, the web content. We believe that the future will be more on what I call multimedia books. Now, these multimedia books are a sophisticated form of books where you are just like a textbook, you are organizing whatever you want to convey in the form of chapters and sections. But each section in turn is made up of video, not just videos, it could be made up of animations, virtual labs, reference docs, everything you want to convey, you are putting it in a more sophisticated form. And one other thing I want to emphasize is that videos are not like just information dump type of a videos. These are interactive videos. So you want to mimic in a classroom setting, typically in a traditional classroom setting, a teacher asks questions, the students, there is some discussion, and then the teacher proceeds. So you do want some aspect of that interactivity to be captured as part of these videos. So these videos are embedded with questions, which when a student answers, he can get some feedback also, like, okay, fine, you answered this, but that's not the right answer because, you know, of these reasons. So you could actually provide that kind of feedback to the student as well. So these are those interactive videos. Not just the videos, these books also come with discussion forums. They can come with a progress tracking, like how well are you doing, not just how well you yourself are doing. How well are you doing relative to others who are also following this multimedia book? So it's like kind of a very powerful medium. I mean, compared to a textbook, this is like a lot more powerful way of disseminating information. So the idea is to create such multimedia books. And then you go ahead to these colleges, ask the teachers there, see, you have been using traditional books. Why don't you try these multimedia books? They're a lot more sophisticated. And importantly, this flipped class mode in the teaching pedagogy has undergone a lot of research. Many claim it's a lot better way of teaching. Of course, there is research going on. It may not work out for all courses, but definitely for some courses, a lot of people feel that this is a good way of teaching. So what this instructor, when he is doing this flipped class mode of offering, is he's going to pull this content from multiple multimedia books. And this, I think, is again a very important aspect, because in India, again, each engineering college will have its own syllabus. You cannot say, okay, fine, this is what I'm teaching, you take. So it's more like everyone has to follow the syllabus. If there were two, three such multimedia books, a specific instructor can assemble what I call a course specific multimedia book by pulling content from multiple multimedia books and then offer this to his students. So that is also, as I said, is particularly important. And then you could track the students' progress, who have watched the videos, how well are they doing in the class, what is their quiz performance. So this Bodhidri platform provides support for hosting such multimedia books, supporting this flipped class mode of operation. And it has the usual support like Moodle-like functionality, like sharing marks, email support, Piazza-style functionality like facilitating discussion. Students can chat with each other while they're, like for example, you're watching, you didn't understand, your friend is online, you can actually chat and get some things clarified. So all this is provided as part of the Bodhidri interface. One other recent thing that we have added is this lab report grading, because a lot of our courses also have a lab component. The way typically it is done is you give some lab, people type, either upload a PDF or a text file, and then the TAs have to manually grade it. But often the students come back with a crib saying, for this, why were my marks detected, or how much did I get for the specific question within a list of questions. So the idea here is, again, to ease the manual grading, we will provide a form-based lab exam. I'll show you a demo of it, where you actually type it, and as the TAs are also, it's like a web form, you can just enter the marks, you can enter comments, everything gets collated, puts into a spreadsheet, and it gets shared with the students based on what marks they have got. So that is the report grading feature. So it's not that we are really the first or something to do in this space. People have been working on this problem for many, many years. Government has invested a lot of money. So NPTEL, CD are some of the things you may be familiar with. So these are the studio classroom recordings where the focus is mostly on students. So you can get these videos from YouTube or IITV server. Even there was CDs that were distributed earlier. Of course, Coursera, edX, everyone knows. These are big time MOOCs players who try to target worldwide students. The way we had differed from the, by the way, Bodhidri is a contemporary of Coursera edX. We kind of started roughly about the same time. But their focus was on MOOCs, whereas our focus from the beginning was on this multimedia interactive books. So the NPTEL CD were not quite, can be considered as this multimedia interactive books. And more importantly, our focus was on this local instructors so that they can do this flipped class mode of teaching. So that is the related work. So in our life cycle, I've covered what the idea is. The idea is to use video material, flip class for teachers. And I'll now talk about how we went about executing it. So this Bodhidri platform is based on the Django Python React.js. These are basically web development framework tools. We also have an Android version of it. So this has arisen mainly because we wanted to provide offline access to the material. Even if you don't have internet, you have internet access, you download some material, then you don't have internet access, you do whatever you want, and then later you sync with the server and the state gets synced. So you could do all your quizzes offline, you could do all your watching of the video offline, but whatever marks you have got gets synced with the main server. So that's where the Android app had come into play. So we built the system based on all these tools. So let me talk about scalability first. So we had conducted this teacher training workshop using this platform. It had about 9,000 participants. And when we started running it, at some point, when there were roughly about 500 simultaneous users of the particular system, things just started to fall apart. Things were, all connections were getting timed out. So it was basically a scalability problem. So we then dug in to see what the issues are. So our first system, so we did some experiments. If it were a static file, which is basically some simple file that you are passing to the system, the server that we have used was able to support 1 lakh requests per second. The moment this entire complexity of this Django, everything came into play, our analysis, this was done some time back, showed that we were not able to support more than 50 requests per second. I mean, it has come down from 1 lakh to 50 requests per second. So that shows the way the code was written as well. So we didn't really pay much attention to scalability, but then we had to dig in a lot of the current state of the art to see how we can employ it to solve this scalability problem. So Memcache, Redis are some caching solutions. We also looked a lot, or in fact in the process of looking as well, as how to optimize code such that things happen, it scales better. We looked at database query optimization. Affinity scheduling is pinning a process to a particular CPU core. So all these aspects had to be looked into. So it was a major learning experience where when you're working on this, the students got to experience. So you cover a lot of stuff in theory, but this is a project where when you're working on it, you got to experiment with tools that are across a wide range of areas. And I learned a lot. The students also had learned a lot. Apart from this, we also started log collection just to ensure that things were working fine, mainly for scalability issues. So if you want to debug, it's important to have logs. And we also used some machine learning based user models derived from the logs so that we could conduct some of the scalability tests via JMeter. So it involved this entire range of technology that we had to use to ensure that the system got built as well as that it gets scaled. So let me show a very quick demo of how the platform looks. So these are, in fact, we are using this currently to run all those courses. So I'll just show you a student view. So if you can see, this is a chapter, physical layer is a chapter. Within this chapter, we have these as the sections. So if you look at a specific section in turn is made up of these two videos, some reference talk, as well as a quiz. This video, I won't play it, but it also has a lot of quizzes. As you can see, it's an interactive video. These quizzes will keep popping up. And it also has out of video quizzes also. Just these are like the homework problems that you give. So this is the interface. And it has, again, as I said, a discussion forum. It has to track. Maybe this I shouldn't show. So it has some assignments you could upload, the lab report, all these are there as part of the system. So let me go back.
When you said multimedia textbook, that those slides plus the video quizzes are what constitute?
The video, everything, whatever you are seeing here. So this CS224 computer networks is a multimedia book. So when you click on it, whatever appears here, this is the organization of chapters and sections, but internally when you click, it gives you, for that particular concept can be explained through multiple videos, slides. I mean, this doesn't have a lab, but it could also have a virtual lab, it could have animations, whatever it is. You are putting everything in one place. So moving on, so after our execution, we have moved on to the field trials. So far, BodhiTree has been used by 13,000 teachers as well as students. So that's something we are quite proud of. So within IITB, we have conducted 9 flipped classes, predominantly in CSE. In fact, we didn't take it out till we were quite comfortable. Only this semester, that too a bit late, we had offered to outside department people. Only 2 had shown interest. Next time on, I think we should do it before the semester began. So we now have multimedia books in computer networks, architecture, wireless networks, as well as software lab. This was also used to conduct a teacher training workshop. This was part of MHRD initiative called Teach 10KT. So this covered about 9,000 engineering college teachers, where there was 1 month of online activity followed by 5 days of face-to-face. Some QEEE workshops were also conducted, which covered about 3,000 students. So we have seen interest from others, like some faculty in math want to use it to do some Maharashtra-wide math teacher training program. Even IDC, they want to do pan-India-wide design course-based offering. A few startups also have approached us for using it for life skill development. Okay. I'll tell you how I organize it. Typically, we have 3 hours of contact hours per week for the students. So what I do is 2 of the hours I give for offline access. So they are supposed to watch for a given week a specific material. So that schedule is kind of fixed. So if I just to show. So I'm basically telling something like, this to this, you watch all those videos. So the schedule is given to them. And because we deal with large class sizes, which are 100 students, which I don't particularly like, so what I do is I divide up the class into 35 students each. And every week, I interact for 1 hour with each of the batch. So from the student's perspective, they have 2 hours of watching the videos and 1 hour face-to-face. But for me, it is 3 hours because I'm dealing with all the students. So these face-to-face sessions typically start out with a quiz. It's a small, what I call tutorial quiz. The reason that the quiz is very important is because if you don't have it, people don't watch videos. That counts towards a grade, so that way they watch the videos. And this is a very simple quiz. You watch the video, you will get full marks in it. It's nothing complicated other than that. Because I shouldn't ask questions where they are not being given an opportunity for me to explain in case they didn't understand. So these are very simple. So after the quiz, I provide a very quick summary of what has happened. And then multiple things. Sometimes I actually say, okay, you learned this. Here is a problem. How will you apply this in this? It becomes a discussion session. Sometimes I just take 2 or 3 of the tougher problems, which are not like it's good if some instructor is there. I make them, I pose it, they're all solving it. I go around looking at how they're solving it. It's a small class, so I tend to cover most of them. And while they work, you know, they make common mistakes because, as I said, I choose somewhat of a tricky problems in class. I just say, okay, see, you didn't understand, that is why you're doing it, but this is how you should do it. So this is the typical mode. It's either some discussion on using this concept, how do you extend it further? Or it's a combination of many of these things. So that is how the face-to-face tutorials happen. Here you could employ, if you're familiar with a lot of this teaching pedagogy, like think, pair, share, or whatever it is, all those can be applied here, just to make it more lively and engaging to the students. So the local instructor has to take on that particular role. So the multimedia book is taking care of the 2 hours. So the local instructor has to engage the students in the tutorial slot, for which, so the same way as I am doing.
How many were there for that exercise?
That is, no, that 9,000, whatever I am doing was for more of a trial. This is not the solving of the problem. I'll get to how to solve the original problem shortly. That was just done to use the system. Earlier, it used to be one intense week of 5 days face to face, and a lot used to get crammed into them. It just becomes too much for them. So what we did was, you said, take 1 month, do at your leisure, whatever you want to learn, then come and let's drive it face to. So when it was, so that 9,000 also is a hierarchical model. So we had 250 center coordinators who were managing their centers locally while I'm directing. But the 250 center coordinators, I did face-to-face with them. But at a later date, after 1 month, the center coordinators helped the local people while I was overseeing the entire operation. No, it is a different, SAFE is the technology we use. I'll get to that shortly. So just to kind of show the feedback that we have got from using this system. So this CS224 is recent spring 2015. This is the survey based on that. About 63 students out of a class of about 95 filled in the survey. In the teacher training workshop, those 225 are the center coordinators. I didn't collect the survey for those remaining who they were guiding. Because I interacted a lot more closely with these center coordinators. So out of 250, 225 had filled the survey. So these are some of the questions we have asked. So we were asking, when you were using Bodhi Tree in this, where the instructor is not physically present, did you feel the need for an instructor? So as you can see, that very much is a very small portion. Of course, the teacher workshop, they felt our students didn't feel that much need for instructor, but sometimes, yes, a good number felt that it would be nice if the instructor was present sometimes. So the question one is about, did you feel the need for instructor presence? And red means very much, blue means sometimes, green means not at all. The left is institute offering, the right is teacher's workshop. So for institute offerings, our own students, teacher's workshop is the MHRD's Teach 10KT program.
So how many of them were there?
That is 60, so this institute offering, 63 students filled the survey, for that 225 teachers filled the survey.
This is the average.
Yeah, this is from Google survey, that's what it projected, I just took it from. Yeah, one class. This is for a single class. So this portion is our CS224, which is our own students, one class. This is the teacher training workshop. That is also one workshop that I have conducted. This is the coordinators who did. They all came here to me. They are across, spread across 250 centers across all of India, but I interacted with them face to face as well as through Flip. So to summarize, they did feel the need for an instructor. So because you are removing the physical instructor, right, it's important to know whether they felt the need for a physical instructor. So this is the result. So we also asked this interactivity portion of the video, how many of them found it useful? Again, as you can see, many, the green says very much. Many of them found it very useful. Similarly, quiz outside is even more. They all thought it's very good that they got to practice a lot. This also shows how much time did you spend on a 20-minute video. A good, of course, there is some portion who spent less than 20 minutes. These are the guys who watch the video at 1.5x or something. Good number spent 20 to 30, but there are some decent number who have spent 30 to 40 as well. So people were watching it at their own pace. So in fact, that is one of the advantages of Flip Class. You can watch things at the pace that is defined by you. So we also conducted, so this is a comparison with the traditional. So we said, okay, you have experienced traditional classes before, now you're experiencing Flip Classes. How do you think your subject understanding, whether it increased, decreased, relative to traditional classes? Did you feel that Flip Classes was reducing your understanding compared to traditional classes? So these are some of the questions we have asked. So if you see, 60% felt that Flip Classes led to better understanding, and 12%, and the remaining are actually, they found both same. Only, if at all you want to say, okay, let's not go for Flip, only 12% actually felt that it decreased their understanding of the subject. So a majority were in favor of flipped classes. Whether this increased the load, in our own institute, 61% felt they did not increase the load much. They were happy with the way things were. But for the teacher training workshop, in fact, only 25% felt it did not increase the load. Many felt that it increased the load significantly of watching. But the reason for that is they all had a daytime job, and then they had to watch this as well. So it's a lot of work for them. Of course, the exam preparedness doesn't apply to the teacher training workshop, but within our own institute, 70% found that flipped classes works better for them to prepare for the exams.
So the 12% says decreases understanding.
Which means they are basically telling, I prefer, in a way, that traditional class teaching helps me understand things better than flipped. That is what they are trying to tell. These people also experience, of course, it's not for the same course, but they have experienced traditional classes as well. So it's relative to the traditional classes they have experienced versus the flipped class that they're experiencing currently. Yeah, it's not the same instructor though. So yeah, there, it's all subjective. In fact, I'll put a lot of disclaimers in the end. Huh. Yeah, rough. I mean, not well. The 60% is basically you are counting. In fact, I'm putting the lower bar. In fact, our own students, it's gone all the way till 80%. The 60% is more from the teacher's training workshop perspective. Our own students, in fact, found it much better.
So, I was just going to add that it would be nice if you could have a controlled experiment.
So,
instead of asking students for their own sort of feeling about this, you could just measure quantitatively their performance.
I'll get to that. I'll show you one other. I don't know if you meant by that, but I'll show you one other figure. So again, finally we ask the question that you know traditional, you know flipped. How would you rate it? 3 means flipped is much better. 2 means okay, it's better. 1 is slightly better, about same. Negative is it's like much worse. So this is what we have done. So as you can see, 83% to 93% prefer flipped mode of teaching to traditional mode. Institute offering is about 83%. Teacher training is 93. One other thing we also try to do is, like, I have taught this course in a traditional fashion before. I've also taught in a flipped class before. I just wanted to compare how the average class marks were changing across these. Lot of disclaimers here. It's a very sample, small sample set. I don't want you to, I'm not just using this to justify flipped classes better. It could be a function of the batch. It could be a function of the specific instructor. I may have put in more effort in that year as opposed to earlier years. There are many variables. All this is saying, it looks positive. Try it out for yourself and then make your own conclusions. I'm no way justifying that flipped is. It looks good. So let me tell what I mean by this. So I had done 2 offerings in traditional, spring 2009-2012, and then I did flipped autumn 2013 and spring 2015. I like to focus on those 2 red ones because this is my second offering based on I've gained some experience and then I'm offering. So it's good to compare a traditional second versus flipped second because I've gained some experience in doing it. So if you see the A's, there isn't that much difference, but the B's, there is a good 10% increase in the, sorry, AB's. And the class average has also increased, not just that, the max marks also have increased. And I like to believe that I have set the similar exam difficulty there versus here. But again, as I said, this is just a sample point, very subjective. So I just wanted to share it, but you really cannot draw any major conclusions from it. You just have to try it yourself, get your own feel for it. Okay, so going back, so we have finished the field trials. So based on our personal experience, surveys, suggestion boxes, whatever it is, we went again, refined it. I won't spend too much time into it. So let me talk about what the, so originally I started with this problem, let's improve engineering education. Now what all I've talked about, I just built this tool. But to really improve the quality of engineering education outside, you need to ask the question, what motivates an average student? Quality material, there is plenty. NPTEL has a lot of excellent, there are a lot of nice textbooks, but people really, it's not really helping much. Why? Just because people care about good, like for example, you have high quality instruction, but it is not part of the syllabus for your exams, you're not going to pay attention to that high quality instruction. Even if you put high quality instruction as part of the syllabus, but if your exams are just a repeat of the previous exams from some common question bank, that is also not going to help you. So you really need a method to ensure that the examination process is also in order to really do well outside. So that is, so our 3 requirements are quality instruction should be part of the syllabus. Examination process should also test understanding and not general rote memorization. And these both should also scale to lakhs of students because engineering students are really quite a lot out there. So again, I'm now going to start another tool and then I'll pull together for the wider adoption. So let me talk about this tool. So originally we call the SAFE, which stands for Smart Authenticated Fast Exams. The origins of SAFE were very simple. So as you see, every flipped class at the beginning, we were having to conduct a quiz and 100 students in a week take it. So the TAs had to manually grade it. It was just turning out to be too much. We wanted something which is very fast, such that students also do not get an opportunity to cheat. So this arose where we thought we'll work on a bring your own device model. Students get their own smartphones in the class. They will authenticate themselves, download the exams, attempt the exam, submit. Everything gets auto graded because the kind of questions we ask can be fit to objective type of questions, because these are just checking whether they've watched the videos or not. So in terms of features, it is based on smart devices plus Wi-Fi. In most cases, it is bring your own device. It comes with auto grading if it's an objective exam. The secure authentication, which is very important, it's not very easy to achieve the scalable and secure. In fact, we had to, you really need to think for just to illustrate the kind of challenges. So a student can self-cheat, by which it means he can access resources from the internet friends via phone, chat, or Bluetooth. He can get resources by that particular fashion. You could also have to address this problem of impersonation, where a student's friend is giving an exam on behalf of the students, where either both are in the class, they are giving exams to each other, or a friend in class is giving exam for both, or someone outside who has access to all these resources is giving exam on behalf of the student. And then the means to cheating is you could compromise the app, you could compromise the operating system, you could exploit bugs in the app or operating system. You could pass on authentication quiz information to a friend who is outside, but who is using a valid app and operating system. So it wasn't a simple thing like, okay, fine, let's do the, because the security aspect is tough. We had to tackle a lot of these things. I won't get, given the time, I'm not going to get into a lot of detail. So the way we have managed this is through extensive logging on the Android system, where we more or less monitor whatever the student is doing. If he's trying to get out, we'll force him back into the app. We've also tried the use of visual manual passwords to ensure that impersonation doesn't get done. We've tried to create Bluetooth maps to figure out the connectivity between the things. We per exam app means you're giving an app specific to the, depends upon the security you want. Each quiz will have a specific app which you have to download, custom fit for that. I mean, if you had a previous app, it won't work. It has to be an exam-specific app. If you break the operating system, there is nothing you can do, like if you root your phone and fiddle around with it. So the way we thought that could be handled is in an exam, you do random seating, and you just ask people to just swap the phones and take the exam. So that way, you don't know where you're going to land up with. Even if you did something to your phone, very likely you are going to get someone else's phone to give the exam. So it's not going to help you much. And there are also a lot of this Wi-Fi bottlenecks. The moment you get Wi-Fi, there's a lot of traffic. Wi-Fi is known not to scale. So we had to handle a lot of these Wi-Fi bottleneck issues. In fact, we are in the process of handling all that. It may not work in all settings, but in some settings, we feel like once you open the app, you're stuck anyway to the app. It's not that you're, it may not work in all settings. I agree. There may be privacy concerns and stuff. But to compensate that for those type of settings, you could see one of the things about this application is that it's very cool, low cost, low maintenance, easy setup, and highly whatever scalable is. You could have like a stock of phones, right? Just like you're investing in a test center with desktops and blah, blah, you are now investing in smartphones where you have, let's say, 5,000 smartphones that are there for your exam. That may not really work, but the costs are going down. Like, it's not so much. Like, 4,000, 5,000, you'll get a very decent, as opposed to investing 30, 40,000 for a desktop. So it's still going to be a lot more cheaper, even if you go with your own smartphone.
So did you actually
No, 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 no. There we. These are for high-end exams, like not really for, because we do. It's you really need to break the OS and do a lot of stuff. I mean, we are. If for example, JEE, I can understand people, but we are not really thinking there yet. For our students, we feel. So we just we don't really do the swapping, but we do this extensive logging. So that, and the app forces them to come back. They cannot get out of the app. They have to decline it, because if they accept it, it will show and I can pull them up. So they are given all these instructions. If a phone call comes, you have to decline. If you accept it, your exam is like, so all these instructions have to be given before. Yeah, you could. Yeah, that is one. In fact, one other things. But it has a Wi-Fi connectivity. Some phones it permits, but not all phones. The Wi-Fi is a big, we need Wi-Fi access. But we are looking into that. In fact,
extensive logging. But I don't understand.
Logging is the case where, for example, whether the app is in focus, what kind of BSS ID are you connected with? Who are the neighboring Bluetooth, whatever things that you are listening to? Are you trying to access the phone? Whatever it is, whatever activity you are doing on the phone, you are trying to log it.
And then you go back and check?
No, it comes as a dashboard. So, for example, that also I can kind of show you a demo of. So, this is the dashboard, and this is what we are logging. So, for example, of course, this is all saying did not submit quiz within the extended time. He is connected to some other Wi-Fi ID. I mean, all these things kind of show up. This is the dashboard for that. So you could, like, while the exam is going, I'm looking at the dashboard. If anything, I'll quickly go there and check what's happening. Yes. Okay. In the interest of, okay, fine. So this we feel is a highly scalable system because it is very low cost. All you're requiring is a Wi-Fi in a room, and thereby it's not like a very complicated power plugs and LAN cabling and desktop setup. So we believe that this will scale much better. So you could use it for classroom quizzes, company placement tests, like our own PhD admission tests, as well as. So this idea of course certification came only after some time into the thing. We didn't really think of it being used for course certification earlier, but since we were dealing with Bodhi Tree and its related issues, we thought this could also be used for course certification. I won't get into this in the interest of time. So let me talk about how. So this is Django Python server again. In fact, we had an older version in PHP, but we decided to move to this for scalability purposes. Android coding in this was one of the toughest because, as I said, you really need to get hold of a lot of this logging information, which is not, Android is not being designed for that kind of a thing. It tries to hide many things. So it was not very easy to achieve, but we managed. But again, versions keep changing, then the APIs change. So again, we have to go back and see whether something else is being exposed now. So it's been a bit difficult. So Wi-Fi scalability was also something. So for this, we in fact developed a crowdsource another Android app where students assemble, the server actually tells, send traffic based on this pattern, and we actually do the Wi-Fi scalability of testing for the access point. For example, I'm using this access point. I want to ask the question, how many users will this access point support given that the user profile is based on the quiz app? In which case, what we do is, in a classroom like my lab, where there are some 60, 70 students, they're just doing the labs. We are just using their phones. So they're kind of volunteering their phones during the thing. We'll just ask them to start this app. The servers pushes some user traffic profile to them. They'll just generate the traffic profile automatically. We collect all the scalability related information, and we can. Otherwise, investing in like 100 phones, whatever, is not an easy thing for us to do. So this is something that came about out of this. So we have used it so far in real quizzes for 5 courses, 4 in CSE. In fact, it's been used by Professor Kannan Maudgalya in his course almost every week. These are real quizzes that count towards their final grade. We have also seen some interest from some companies for the placement tests, as well as other, but they haven't really used it yet. So we are trying to push for it. So now let me go back to the original problem. I started all this saying, let me solve the problem of engineering education. Now let me try to pull together both the tools and explain how we intend to do. This is our current plan. Our plan keeps changing based on whatever hurdles we experience. So it's a forever changing plan. The current plan is this. So in our ecosystem, there are basically three players: industry, which feels the pain of a poor workforce. And then there are this academia, which consists of both content developers as well as students and teachers. So we are thinking that all these players can interface via a non-for-profit company or for-profit company, whatever works out easier in the longer run. So the idea is the following. So we'll currently focus on 5 to 6 core subjects in CSCE, because these are the top engineering, most of the engineers belong to these disciplines. And we will involve the industry from the beginning to ensure that the syllabus that we create kind of meets their needs. So that way, whoever you are producing will satisfy the needs of the industry. Of course, as academicians, we also want to emphasize on concepts. So that is also something that we will do. Once we create the syllabus in cooperation with industry, then the content developers are going to create the multimedia books based on the syllabus. And then the company is going to do this outreach where it will try to push for adoption of these multimedia books in local engineering colleges, as well as target the students directly. And then, because as I said, examination is also a very important process, so this company will also conduct this high quality exams, a bit like GATE, and also a bit like a university model, but these are course specific exams. It will do pan India. These exams are set by content developers or competent teachers. It can, in fact, be vetted by the industry also to check whether it's all being fine. And this conduction of the exam could be via SAFE to scale it, but it could also happen with local engineering colleges with their support, whatever. That logistics have to be figured out. So we, through SAFE means objective exam, because it's easy to grade, but we as, again, instructors, we like subjective exams also, because not all things can be tested by objective. But objective exam could be a filter for that. I mean, if you didn't even clear the objective exams, then forget about subjective. Only those who have good performance in objective can be given a subjective test. That has to be manually graded, for which we'll again try to rely on the student workforce or local engineering teachers or whatever it is to grade. So the certification is also provided by the company. It could be per course or bunch of courses. There's actually a grade assigned to it. Again, here we can work with local colleges to include this within their college transcripts, or you can do it independently. But more importantly, to close the loop so that everyone buys into the system, this will also run a placement cell, in fact, a pan-India placement cell, where it's trying to put together the industry needs will be conveyed, and it'll put the students in touch with the industry. So this is the envisioned plan. I mean, we are trying to see if it will work out by talking to different people. So that's where things are. Okay. Quickly, finally I've told a lot of stuff. So that is more or less the life cycle of a development project. I told idea, how we implemented it, how we did field trials, and then we got some feedback, we refined it, and we are currently in that wider adoption phase. So that's how things are. In the process, what is it that we have learned? So the major hurdles that we see in our system are that these projects typically span many years because there are a lot of stuff you think they'll finish, but many things get added. They become complex, in fact, as you go along. But we work with a moving student population. So some work only for one sem, some work for a year. Rarely do we get anyone who works more than a year. And project staff, we haven't been able to hire good project staff. Even project staff, if they've been hired, they also leave within 1-2 years. It's not that they are sticking around for that long. The problem with this is that most coders are inexperienced. I mean, they're also still learning. In fact, we offer this as a learning experience for them. Like, do this, you learn about a lot of these things. So the end result of it is that you get inefficient code, buggy code, poor documentation, they don't follow any coding standards, and when you are trying to use it, a lot of issues this tends to create. The number of work hours also, if it's an R&D, these are good students work these many hours. I mean, of course, there are students who may not even work these many hours, but R&D means they'll work 6 hours a week. BTP means 6 to 12. MTP is 20 to 30, rarely 40. So this is how it is. And you may think we are dealing with students, we are in a position of power, they can be quite unforgiving. I mean, if they feel that the grade is getting affected because you are experimenting with all these new things, they are scathing in their anonymous reviews, if not directly on your face. So one has to be, either you will have this unforgiving end users where they expect polished products, bug-free products, or you will have this clueless users, which we have seen in some of the teacher training, is they are very not tech savvy. So then it becomes a lot of customer support kind of a thing that you have to provide. So you better be very user friendly, such that you can avoid all those kind of technical support you have to provide for them. And not just this, all these users will come with different devices, different operating systems, different browsers, different internet speeds. These are also a lot of things we had to handle as part of the project. So what are the lessons that we have learned? Faculty can definitely take up such projects without knowing, or I'm like an example of, I don't know anything about Django, I don't know anything about React.js, I know very little about Android or Python, but still I've been able to manage these projects as well as many other projects. I think it mainly is possible because you need to ask the right questions. So whatever logic they want to do, you need to vet it through some flowcharts. And whatever code they're doing, you need to ask questions like, okay, how many, by the way, this is all come post experience. It didn't start out like this. These are all lessons learned. Now I insist, but I didn't do it before. How many database queries are they making? How many requests are getting generated? What is your execution time? All these, and you have to think of all corner cases and test it. I mean, the burden is on you. So you have to be ready to do all this. Another thing which has been invaluable, in fact, anyone who wants to do this kind of work, I will insist that they should invest in a software management tool. The kind of tool that we use is from Facebook. It's open source. Sorry, it should be Facebook. It's called Fabricator. It's basically a wrapper around a version control like Git or Bitbucket. The nice thing about this tool is that it imposes a coding standard. All this documentation or indentation or naming conventions, everything it will ensure. That way, if you're doing sloppy code, you cannot push. It also permits peer code review. You can assign it like this can be pushed only if someone else approves the code. That is also something very important. It also supports this unit testing. It's kind of painful to write them, but in the long run, it's important because if something failed, when you run the unit test, you know exactly what module it's not working. So it's for each module people code, they have to specify how to test that module also. That's the unit testing. So it will help you track bugs, assign tasks, it has a chat room, it has wiki, all these tools it comes with. This is something which is worth investing in. So again, we didn't really think of scalable. When we started, it was like a project. We thought, okay, fine, we'll do something about it. But then our final goal in many of these projects is that we do want it to scale. And if you don't give scalability enough weight from the beginning, it will come and bite you. I mean, we did Bodhi Tree and now we have, there are many times where we thought, let's scrap all this code, start from scratch, just because it's turning out to be so messy because we didn't pay enough attention. But then it's not easy to do it because it's 50,000 lines of code with a lot of, I mean, it's no one is there who is, so you have to work with the code. So from the beginning, you have to pay attention to scalability and logging. We have tried, so what we are now insisting is like there are a lot of tools which you can use during coding to and quantify your performance and push only when it meets a certain bar. Again, as I said, for say, for example, we in fact ditched our previous implementation. We have started from scratch based on our experience and we are recoding it. There are a bunch of students I have assigned certain pieces of code. I had to abandon it because there wasn't enough reason to use it or temporarily suspended thinking, okay, if the need arises, I'll visit it. Another thing which again in a research institute, I think we have to pay attention to, but these type of things, publications are hard. these are using existing ideas to solve some problems, so the community may not think these are particularly novel. So it's difficult to sell novelty. But there are other venues where you can publish, but that is something which you are not familiar with. So it takes time to get to know what that community expectations are and then write and publish. But finally, I think personally, I feel it's basically a trade-off. Publication needs a lot of rigor. It needs a lot of effort you have to spend. Adoption also needs, in fact, 10 times more work. You have only so much time. You decide whether you want to push for this or push for that. So that is something to keep in mind when you're trying to publish this type of work. It's doable. It's a lot of work. So as I said, for wider adoption, we are in the process. We haven't yet learned many lessons there. But one thing which I have felt in retrospect is, had I involved all the players in the ecosystem from the beginning, maybe things would have moved on much faster. But I mean, this is a lesson which I think many people in developmental projects are aware of it. But yeah, since we were the producers, we were the consumers, because I teach, I also am building it. So it was working out fine. But if you want to take it out, you do need to involve other players from the beginning. So this is another lesson. Quickly, I'll just take 5 more minutes and wrap up, and it's already kind of exceeding the time. So whatever I've covered so far are, again, what we call educational tools that started to solve that specific problem. We have a bunch of other tools, simple apps that we are also, in fact, they are at a state of quite maturity. In fact, we are at the field trial stage for all of these apps. Let me motivate this in this particular setting. Suppose I have this presentation, and you all want to have this present. Like typically in a conference setting, someone gives a talk, and you want access to that particular person's file, right? Right now, it's like, okay, someone will upload, you download. But this is a method where if you have this app, and I just say, okay, share this file, and it kind of goes to everyone. So there are usages for that kind of file sharing in classroom settings where I want to share. There isn't prior preparation. On the fly, I just want to share something. Conference talk setting. So the sharing is based on multicast. Multicast is a very old problem. In theory, everyone understands it very well. But it's not been widely adopted. So a lot of standards, APIs, don't support the required functionality needed for it. So technically, solving this has been very difficult because of limitations of the smartphone API in exposing some of the APIs, as well as you run into a lot of scalability issues. So we are kind of trying to build one such app where everyone within a room can share files in a convenient fashion. So this is something we have seen today afternoon. In such a room, I have the mic. You don't have mic. You have some questions to ask. Someone runs around with a mic, passing the mic around. Again, this is an app that tries to help that particular problem there's a speaker with the mic, there is audience. If the audience want to ask a question, it's a local Skype call between you and me, and it kind of plays out through my smartphone, through my mic. So that way everyone gets to, so there is a floor control that is needed, but it's a Skype call that is going via, playing out via my mic. So this is also useful in this kind of talk settings as well as large classes. When there are students asking questions, you just do some floor control. The instructor can do some floor control. Again, Doubts Clear app is something, again, that arose in the afternoon. So I think Sudarshan was trying to say how many want this question answered. So similarly, in this setting also, let's say there are a lot of questions. Often what happens is we randomly pick someone, and that may not be it may be a boring question. It may not be of relevance to many others. So the idea here is, while a talk is going on or whatever, you have a question, you type it in the app, it goes to everyone, then they will like it. And whatever is the most popular question is what an instructor can kind of take it up and discuss it with the audience. So this also has usage in large class settings as well as conference room settings. So these are some of the apps that that we are working on. I, in fact, mentioned some social work. I knew there won't be enough time, so I didn't touch upon that. So I'll do it some other time. So just to summarize, developmental projects use current technology to solve some local pain points. gives a lot of satisfaction. In fact, I've been quite happy with this work. Feels great to see your work being used in practice. And these can be very technically challenging as well. I mean, these were not like easy. I've learned a lot in the process. In fact, you learn many things across a variety of topics. That's been a very intellectually stimulating exercise as well. But they do come with a lot of hurdles. Technical hurdles naturally are easier to cross, but there are other hurdles which are like business plans and ventures and whatever are not in your control. And naturally, I should conclude this with a big word of thanks to the amazing set of, I mean, I've been very fortunate. You know, when you take up a project, it's a lot dependent on the kind of students who are working on it. And I've had consistently good students who have done amazing. They've owned it up, they've viewed it as their own baby and worked. And I think that is what has led to the success of these projects. So very big thanks to many years. It's been 3 years. Every year I have some bunch of students who have done outstandingly well. So big thanks to them. So to conclude again, thanks. If your faculty, please consider adopting some of these tools as part of your teaching. And if your students, please cooperate with the faculty when they use these tools. I mean, we finally want to experiment with new ideas, kind of try to push it to the outside world. Some bugs you have to put up with, but overall, we'll try to make it a pleasant experience. And again, if your faculty, again, a sincere request would be that develop such multimedia books so that we can take it out to the outside world. And if your students help us give feedback to such books so that they're in a good shape so that we can take it out, rest assured we'll make the task easy and enjoyable. So that I'll stop. Any questions or? Okay.
But we are still concerned. We'd like to try it out in our project.
Okay.
One is multimedia books, and the other is a large online test that we do with the students. We expect them to be in front of PCs.
Mm-hmm.
But if we can do it in front of phones, then it makes a big difference. But the biggest question I had is, if one wanted to work with any of these things, as you quite rightly pointed out, who is the support staff?
So we are towards that, right? That company will be the. So we are trying to form a company where you are trying, so that will take care of all of these. Because, so one of the things which I have not mentioned is students get on these projects when there is some intellectual challenge. These are when you reach a certain level of maturity, it is just bug fixes and some minor fixes here and there. It doesn't intellectually stimulate the students, and it's not fair for us also to give that kind of projects to the students. So at that point on, it has to get out of the system. So we are, I mean, one of the ideas in that Section 8 company in general is that it need not be just for these two projects. We want to keep a wider, what is the term? We'll keep it wide enough that many other projects could also use that company to reach out to the outside thing. So the charter is not just this. It could be much wider than this. And because it's you are going to make money, you will charge for the certification in this particular model or whatever it is, we are hoping we can employ people at industry at par rates and do the advertising. These things, you have to do a lot of advertising. You have to do a lot of outreach. It's not possible to do it in an industry, in an academia setting like ours. You need to invest in marketing. You need to invest in a lot of tech support. Some company has to do it. So that's what we are working towards. We have to see how it's going to work out.
I particularly like the student question part, because in our new building we have two labs which will function as a single virtual lab.
Okay.
So for questions to be answered there, something like that.
The doubts clear up.
That will be very useful. The doubts clear and the
mid-cap ones.
Yeah, mid-cap.
Yeah, sure. They are ready. We want to try it out. The field trial is where we'll try it out more in the next sense.
What is the experience with Wi-Fi scalability?
So
how much can you push it?
So this quiz app that we have been using in the regular thing, 30 students connect That's it. It doesn't permit. I think it's more of a configuration problem in our IETP wireless access points. I think some parameter has to be changed. Then I think it will. They're not. It's not permitting them to associate itself. But we have our own access point, which is given from airtight networks, like someone we interact with. That one is able to handle 70 users. So we haven't really tried beyond 70 because that is the limit. I mean, it's not that those are the number of students who are taking the test. Had there been 100, we would like to try it out. So we are trying to do some scalability tests by actually incentivizing students to come for a dummy test, and we'll get some 150 people in and do a dummy test and run some. So we have an entire different infrastructure to monitor all that. So we'll do more scalability tests. Definitely 60, 70 can be handled in a given room with one airtight access point, that is. IETB, we have to change the configuration and check whether it can support more.
Yeah, so that's what we did. So earlier we changed, like,
we put two access points operating on different channels, 30 plus 30. With IETB, it works. But not, I mean, airtight is able to handle pretty well because we changed a lot of the driver configurations.
How would things have been different if you were a consultant for them versus, you know, deeply involved in the work?
Oh.
How would the difference be coming out in the final analysis?
So when you are very involved in these kind of, see, again, I mentioned this before, I'm the producer, I'm the provider, I'm also the consumer. So I get a lot of this nitty-gritty details of what is happening in the classroom, what works. For me as an instructor, students interact with me, tell me what they like. So this too specific, because they're in the educational space, I'm also in it. It's been a lot of I was able to contribute better because I understand the space better. But if it is some kind of a, where you are only involved at a consultancy level, I don't think it would have evolved with the level of attention to detail I have paid for this particular product. You have to immerse yourself in this to be really able to. That I don't think would have come with a consultancy kind of a job, because I've spent Bodhi Tree invariably has at least 10 plus students working on it at any given semester. So it's a lot of, you have to get involved in a lot of depth, which typically in a consultancy project you don't get.
You would have people who are hopefully equipped with the tools that you had to learn on your own.
Yeah.
So in that sense,
it will probably the load, but I agree. If it's again a consultancy is like again you. So you, if you are doing it on your own, you know a lot of nitty gritty details. You know what is working, what is not working. I don't know if as a consultancy whether my involvement was as much. Like I'm just, instead of doing the students doing it, the company is doing it, and then I'm using it. I'm experimenting. Maybe things would, I may give feedback and say do this, do that, and if they do it, then maybe it'll be all right. But I don't know. I haven't really. Maybe it could reduce my load significantly.
Sharat. Huh. And Moodle are, you know, off-the-shelf things that I can sort of download and get going on day one, right? Bodhi Tree as a multimedia book requires, I mean, the most important thing is the book. So I have to develop my own book if I'm a faculty member, right? Are there some, you know, I think it might be useful to have some important ways and tools and mechanism, best practices about how to go about developing this.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, if you remove Bodhi Tree, if you remove the multimedia book out of the Bodhi Tree, then it doesn't seem to have that many features.
No.
Am I right?
No. So, for example, the IER professor who is using Bodhi Tree, he has absolutely no video content. He's just using it in place of Moodle. And it is, I wouldn't know whatever Moodle supports currently is also supported. But there are other things like discussion forum and this, what is it, this report grading if you want, or this monitoring in case you are assigning a quiz, outside homework kind of quizzes, it will monitor how the students are performing, doing auto grading and everything. So I view this as an advanced version. If even forget about multimedia book, you don't want to do multimedia book, you don't do it. But still, I think it is a more sophisticated platform than Moodle, and which will help you. You don't have to really do, but you are losing a good portion of the stuff, but still there are enough features within it which will work well as a replacement to Moodle. There are many people who are using, two people who are using it outside our department are using it as a replacement for Moodle. They've just wanted to try it out, I guess.
I would recommend this over.
For what reason is your question? Yes.
So one thing which I don't know, I've heard Moodle supports it, but I personally have never used it, is for me to share marks with the students. I just upload a CSV, each person gets to see his own whatever marks. I don't know if Moodle, I have not used any such aspect of Moodle, so that is something this thing supports. The other thing is the discussion forum also. Like typically I don't want my content to be on Moodle and then use Piazza. This is like in one single integrated system where you have your discussion forum. In fact, it is per concept discussion forum. Also, like if in a given concept you are covering, putting three PDFs and you want people to discuss that, then it will be per that as well as overall. So there are all these things that are there which may help an individual instructor.
The two things that you have said, it is currently supported by Moodle, as in the gradebook.
Yeah, I know, that is what, but that's why I said I
used it, so I don't really know.
Discussion forums which are topic wise and other things, that also is being supported by Moodle with very different features.
Okay.
So my question would have been, okay, now it is a very hypothetical situation, as if you enter into market and if you are going to compete against Moodle, which is highly...
If I'm entering the market, I'm entering it for flip class support. I'm not entering for anything else.
Moodle offers enough plugins, and there are dedicated developers who are actually working on it and developing more more better solutions. So how would you try to compete against them? Would have been one question that I would.
So to Moodle, see, there is, so multimedia book, as I said, is an organization of chapters, sections and stuff, right? Moodle may permit something. It's also a clean interface thing wherein, in a way, in fact, other than Moodle, your question should be, how would you compete with Coursera or MOOCs, because Coursera or edX, because it's 90% or 95% is very similar, right? It's Moodle is like for a different thing. This is very similar.
Does it support, for example, an interactive video where while you're watching the video, things pop up?
With the H5P plugin, the questions pop up, and all these features are currently supported by
Moodle. Yeah, but this is
like a 3-year-old. At that time, Moodle. So when this thing started, one of the reasons why we have started building it here was there wasn't anything out there to do this. So edX was open source 1 year after this particular project was in. In fact, I already used it one course offering. That is when edX was open. So there was nothing out there for me to do. All said and done, there are many systems out there. I don't think, you know, when you are doing this business, it's not going to be about a lot of things out there. Finally, what it boils down to is how you are able to implement and push it. Features, you're not going to sell based on this. It's more about what business model do you have, how are you outreaching, what kind of marketing you're doing, what are you pushing. Those all matter a lot more than the specific technology platform. You replace BodhiTree with edX, it still will not solve that specific problem that I'm talking about. So this arose at that time because there wasn't anything out there. We were all contemporaries in doing all this. This has evolved with this specific nitty-gritty details may vary. But right now, I think what is important is how exactly are going to use it to solve that specific problem. This tool or that tool is less important than actually doing it out in the outside world.
One last question.
Computationally intensive modules in your system. So is it just supporting large number of requests, or are there other computations?
So for example,
most computationally intensive is this. So you are tracking this. There is a feature called scorecard, which or maybe the progress, like when you are displaying what marks I have got across entire textbook, you have to make a lot of database queries to get individual this chapter, this concept, what all marks have you got, and then aggregate all of it and then present it to you. So that is one thing. But again, as I said, it's been whatever designed by people who don't, these are the inexperienced coders. Maybe there is enough database, whatever optimization you could throw in. In fact, that's what we are trying to do now, is to reduce the number of database queries where, like when we did a in-depth study, we saw that for some of it, it's taking 325 database queries for one request. I mean, that's how people have coded. And then through optimization, we got it down to 20. So we are kind of paying attention to that kind of level of detail as well.
I see as a bottleneck is you are saying that the instructors have to customize their course, you know, by pulling together the videos and material. I don't think our teachers have the capability in the colleges. You have to, you know, give them the whole thing in a platter. Even then they may not be easy. So how do you expect teachers to look at their curriculum and then saying that this course will need these modules, pull it all together? That requires quite a bit of, you know, you should have some designing capabilities, you should have some...
No.
We are saying, see, for example, if you take a regular textbook, you have two textbooks in your hand, you go through the table of content, you will say, I will use this section, this chapter, these two sections, and under this textbook, this chapter, these two sections. You're just reading the whatever title. All you're doing here is just the same specification. When you say, I want to create a specific textbook for or multimedia book for my offering, it is just giving you a list of the table of content for both, and you're just selecting what you want, and then it will merge everything together and display it to you. So it's no whether, I mean, if that itself they're not able to do, then it's a different, you don't have to do it also. Then you say, stick with this book that I'm giving you and be whatever happy. That also you can do, but it's not like that they have to create. If they want to create, all you are telling is a way to specify what chapter, what sections within the chapter you want to be included in your offering. It's just a selection, that's it. And the system will take care of everything else. No, we right now, as I said, we have only four, we are trying to recruit content developers to create more such multimedia books. So that's what we are trying right now. Last, Parag.
So there is a lot of interaction happening. So like, did you look at interface design or interaction design at some point in other than technical design? There is a bunch of other design things which are which might
the be UI more, design you're talking about.
So we have paid some attention to it, but as I said, it is attention from me. As a whatever, but I do care about whether when someone clicks something, how many clicks does a person has to click to reach some required information. That level of user that detail, I have given some attention to it, but it's not like some IDC person, if they do it, that kind of systematic study has not happened. But I do, whenever the front UI, because I teach, I know, I mean, what it means for a teacher to the level of depth he has to go, or from a student perspective. So again, because we are using it within our own thing, the students who are doing my course in flipped class are the coders. So they know from their perspective what are the pain points. and they fix it.
Coders are very poor designers of design elements, not a code designer, but a visual designer.
You check out the site. I'm personally quite happy with the job that they have done, because I also, you know, you could do well, but many things have worked quite smoothly without any hassle, and all interfaces are very well done. I mean, some of, as I said, there's a lot of people who have worked on it are these hacking coders, like whose bread and butter is coding. I mean, they are immersed in it. So those are the kind of people who have worked on this project. All of them have got placed in like Facebook, Twitter, all like top whatever. So they are, you know, they're quite capable. In fact, that gave me hope, you know, because it's not an easy thing to manage, but the kind of students who have worked on it have been amazing. So I haven't had too many issues. And as I said, these people have experienced the system themselves. So they know, I mean, that this is a pain point for me. I'm not able to visualize it properly, or it's not displaying properly. They come up with their own ideas and implement it. And they just run it by me. But I agree, like, it's not undergone a proper IDC. In fact, since they are part of the system, they are offered to do the design, to check that the design matches the IDC background. So hopefully, with their input, it will improve further.
Well, okay.
Thanks.
Engaging topic, and okay. A lot of conversations have started. It can certainly continue, but for the moment, outside of. So please join me in another round of applause for our